master photographer Chuck Stewart this past Friday. Chuck was a sublime artist and a sublime man. He was so very dear to me. The thing that is abundantly clear when you look at Chuck's photographs, his subjects loved and trusted this man. In the pantheon of jazz imagery, I cannot imagine anything greater than his portrait of John Coltrane. I have many photographs in my home, but this particular image hangs as a shrine, not only to Train, but to a spirit world that seldom makes its way onto a two-dimensional surface. This level of emotional access is not easily or often granted. Chuck did not have to ask. It belonged to him by virtue of who he was. I knew and loved many of Chuck's magical pictures long before I knew Chuck. I don't remember where or when we met, but we became fast friends. I was stunned and flattered by his admiration of my work. When I was researching pictures for my film on Abby Lincoln, I asked if he had any never-before-seen pictures of her. Chuck generously opened his entire archive of images to me with no limitations or restrictions whatsoever. I am so thankful that I took the number 67 bus to Teaneck just a few months ago to show Chuck a rough cut of the film. I wanted him to see the extent that his beautiful images inform this film's tenor and aesthetic. In addition to the many stunning portraits of Abby and the images of Max and Abby in their various recording sessions, Chuck's photographs of their wedding day offer a precious interlude, a scrapbook of tender and rarefied history through his brilliant eyes. Chuck got his start in the record industry as Herman Leonard's assistant and quickly ascended. When Herman decamped to Paris, he gave his studio to Chuck, and that was that. Through the years, Chuck shot thousands of album covers for a wide ranging of collected music icons, from Ellington to Judy Garland, to Sinatra, to Ray Charles, to Coltrane, Monk, and Mingus. He told me that, given how fast and furious it all happened, he fell into the practice of providing the record labels with only what they needed, a cover and two publicity photos, and then would move on to the next job. He never looked back. When I went through his contact sheets of Abby and Max, I realized the degree of his genius. His greatest images had never even been printed. Chuck was sweet, funny, wise, generous, and nobody's fool. He always spoke his mind, and although gentility was not a hallmark of his delivery, his brutal honesty and fabulous mischievous spirit was. I feel so very privileged to have been his friend, comrade, and the fortunate recipient of his love, respect, and generous heart and soul.